Good morning and welcome to the news review segment of the Power Breakfast Show. This morning in my panel I have Mheshimiwa Simba Arati, Member of Parliament for the Great North, Mheshimiwa Vincent for the sake of this panel I will call you Mheshimiwa. Why don't you want
to? Amen to that.
Anyway, and it's actually wishing you well, Vincent Kimosop is an analyst and also our guest today, and also Deputy Governor Nairobi, Mheshimiwa Jonathan Mweke. Mheshimiwa, welcome.
Good morning.
You accept to be called Mheshimiwa?
Yes.
Why do people fear this?
I think
dare call a member of parliament any name other than Mheshimiwa and you'll be in trouble.
I'm a leadership student. Mm-hmm. Leadership is honorable. Those who desire to lead desire high calling and to be held by a high standard, and that's why the name honorable. We do not know if the current members or those who are serving in leadership position are honorably conducting themselves. That's a debate for another.
Do you desire to lead?
I am a leader myself.
So you are honorable?
Yes.
Goes without saying.
Thank you.
Why do you people get offended when I don't say honorable?
There is no, we don't take offense.
Really?
You see, we are servants.
Uh-huh.
Despite the fact that we are honorable, but we serve the people. Therefore, if you call me servant, I'll be more happier than even honorable.
Than honorable.
Yeah.
I wonder why Jonathan Mweke doesn't want to be called His Excellency.
Well, it was a title that was that's reserved for governors around the world, but the members of parliament thought otherwise. So apparently if you call me Excellency, you can be fined ₦1,000,000 or be sent to jail for a year.
But honestly, why do we legislate over
I don't know what the MPs issues were up to.
I thought we need to legislate over more important things than the charge of the common.
Eh?
Exactly.
What was the grudge?
It's a worldwide practice.
I know it's water under the bridge, but come to think of it.
There isn't a grudge, because what happens is most of members of parliament are going for the seat of the governor. Therefore, I don't see there is any grudge. It's only that we need to bring a lot of decorum.
And now this is the time they will wish they never legislated over
precisely.
Respect is earned. And for example, somebody like his party leader does not enjoy any constitutional position. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to the hierarchy in power in the country, he will even tell you that when they are doing their posters, most of the ODM leaders will have the poster of the party leader. Yet, the people who enjoy constitutional position, when it comes to power hierarchy, they are nowhere. So, it is because you earn respect. So, Mheshimiwa Arati, you guys need to admit when you are discussing this issue, either you are envious of Mweke and the trappings of power.
You see, you can't.
You've said that you stand for higher calling.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Tomorrow, what happens if Simba goes for the governmental?
He will wish they never.
That is it.
But that's different, Mheshimiwa, from the legislation you carried out. It is okay, we wish you well, by the way, if you're going, all the best and any support you need, we will give you. But the question will be, why did you legislate over titles?
Instead of focusing on more important things.
Yeah, because, I mean, I agree with my colleague here. It's just a title. Some of these things are neither there, here nor there. Mm. But, you know, seriously, there's more important things to legislate.
And I think the most important thing that came out of that chit-chat is that respect is earned.
Yes.
From the way you behave, from the way you talk, from the way you give service to others.
Mm. Right.
And
from the way you carry yourself out.
Precisely.
Yeah.
Now let's look at the dailies today, starting with the Standard. The headline there is Uhuru Shocker for Jubilee Aspirants. We'll be looking at that in details. Of course, there's the story that goes on page 6. Standoff in NASA over joint party nominations race. And Jonathan here, an insider in Wiper Party, will be telling us more about this grumbling that we started hearing over the weekend. Of course, the police are probing the haste where ₦4 million cash in transit was robbed from a supermarket along Thika Road. There's a story about land somewhere in Rift Valley. Big losers in Makto's land ruling vow to fight as squatters' decade-long battle for vast land is also looked at. Court at one point had the president ordered they be given the property, but that has not come to be, and so there's a lot of grumbling that's about a parcel of land in the North Rift. Other stories, page 6, we'll be looking into details, the story about secondary school bullies now facing expulsion, as this wave seems to have come from nowhere. Gentlemen in the panel here will be telling us more about their opinion. And an interesting story, page 7 of the Standard. Kenya borrows 95 billion shillings to sink deeper into debt. And he says the cost for borrowing is becoming a matter of concern. The Standard has details about Siasa 2017, counting 56 days before Kenyans go to the poll to elect their representatives in the next dispensation. And of course, there are the stories about sports from across the world. The Daily Nation has the headline about the rancher who was shot by the gunmen somewhere in Laikipia, Sosiani Ranch, after allegations about the shooting at of the police chopper carrying Inspector of Police Mr. Boynette. Also on the front page of the Daily Nation, IEBC sets new deadline for voter listing. We were talking about that off camera a short while ago, and we'll be delving into that later as we go through the papers. Now, the Odinga family disowns a story that appeared in the Daily yesterday about their ailing daughter Rosemary, who apparently at the moment is recuperating down south. They say nobody in the family talks to any journalist, and so they are appalled about the story whose title was "Why I Fear for My Daughter" in one of the dailies yesterday. President Uhuru Kenyatta, as well as other leaders, are expected to be attending late Nderitu Gachagua's burial at his Hiriga home today from around 11 o'clock. And of course, there are the stories about the different coalitions traversing the country trying to woo voters well before campaign time. And Vincent, I think we'll be looking at that more. Not forgetting what the politicians will be saying. Of course, I know they'll be saying something like, we are only urging people to turn out and vote. But let's start with the Daily Nation. The issue in Laikipia, rancher is shot dead, police chopper is fired at, the police say no, Inspector General Boynette was not in that chopper, and 50,000 cattle, goats and sheep have been driven into private ranches by herders in search of pasture following drought. What is happening about security here?
We have seen, this is not the first time, when the president, the deputy president was in Baringo, you saw he was shot at. Mm-hmm. And indeed he had to take off to his car, you know, under the security.
Was he really shot at? Or
Right. When he left...
Guns were fired.
Yeah, they were fired.
Near function where
and was. Indeed the chief was killed. Therefore, a chief was killed in that event. Mm-hmm. But what happens is that we are seeing a country where people are disillusioned completely with the security of this country, where the people are in charge. The second in command, who is the deputy president, if you show that, who is Boynette. Therefore, people there are ups and arms that guys, especially for the people at Laikipia, you know, there is drought. It's not unexpected. But then there is these people who have a big land. They would be given some time, you know, they graze their heads, then after the rain has come, they go back to their lands. But now here the government, of course, the government has said, no, you can't get into the ranches.
Of course, it's a private property.
Precisely. But here we are discussing about lives of other people. Then when you have something in your house, others are dying on the other side, give them some small thing to eat. Therefore, the issue of insecurity of this country is out of hand.
Three things. One is that it brings to the whole issue about the need for us to manage our resources in a sustainable manner. When we look at the big ranches vis-a-vis the community, the reality is that the balance between those ranches and their community interests, how do they work out in a way that, for example, they might have dams inside and this is somebody who's invested. So we need to send the right signal to investors that your property will be protected and respected by the state, but at the same time the element of community outreaches and support. Now that brings to the fore the how do we manage our resources in a sustainable manner? How do we take heed of weather predictions? Like, for example, this was predictable. So what would we have done? And it's good we have politicians in the executive and in the legislature. What were they doing on the ground? And then, and also the element of the timing. You cannot rule out the issue of politics in this. And land invasion for the past has been something that happens, for example, in those zones, particularly in a political season. Actually, there is a clip from a politician inciting people to actually invade those land. And this is a popular short-term way of mobilizing communities. And I do not know why. Maybe one of the things we need to ask, why is it that law enforcement tend to be softer when it comes to an election year?
And especially towards
Look at even Nairobi. Towards the an election year, you'll start seeing more and more hawkers, and the enforcement of the law is not done with the severity that you will see, for example, in a first year when somebody gets it. So it's just that it's different dimension, different faces, but it's an issue to do with resource management, it's an issue to effective law enforcement, and also the signal that we send to investors about our consistency to the rule of law, which is part of really of our national value.
Quite a pertinent issue you've mentioned. It's an issue to do with politics. You can't rule it out, like you said. Jonathan, he just hinted at something you people suffered the other day. Towards an election year, you will see more hawkers in the streets.
I guess my friend is misinformed. The hawkers were brought back by a court order. The county government's policy, the stand remains the same, that obstruction is against our bylaws, and if you obstruct people's property, if you obstruct people's shops, we're going to enforce on it.
These two incidences seem different but almost the same. On one hand, we have licensed shop owners, and we have Kenyans who are eking out a living, the hawkers, and in the Laikipia, we have conservationists who are licensed, and we have cattlemen and herders who need grazing land and water for their people.
You know, when the president is being sworn in, one of the major things that he gets sworn in for is to protect the lives and property of Kenyans. Yeah. Now, there's people who have needs, but there is law. And that's why you have law in a country. If you don't follow the rule of law, then what else do you have left? The law protects people's lives and property. Now, if your cows are thirsty, if you are hungry, that doesn't give you a license to go and invade somebody's property, burn their property, and kill them. If you need to sell your wares and you need to etch a living, that doesn't give you a license to go in front of somebody's shop who's paying rent, who's paid a business license, who's also trying to edge his living, block their doors and sell your wares in front of their doors. It doesn't. And that's why we have the law. And we're not going to get anywhere, Charles, until we start following the law. Now, this insecurity you're seeing in Baringo, you're seeing it in Laikipia, you're going to start seeing it in other areas if there's no consequence to it. And so the more the government does not pay attention to this insecurity, the more other Kenyans will think it's okay to commit crime, because you'll get away with it. Then you end up having a lawlessness, a complete lawless country. And then you can't have investors, nobody has confidence to come and do anything in this country, and you end up getting upside down.
So resource management, rule of law, agreement with investors when they are coming in, because apparently there are ranchers, there are conservationists in the Laikipia who are doing very well. They have a very good rapport with the locals. They have sunk boreholes, they have dug out wells, they have done dams, they have built schools, and they relate so well. Actually, you find the locals protecting these investors.
Yeah, it's if you take care of a people, they say, don't tell us how much you care, show us that you really care. And you will find that when you have a good community outreach, because the reality is some of those ranches provide employment, they have become a hub for endangered species. If you go to Sweetwaters, for example, and you'll find the rhinoceros, so you can actually see they have invested in supporting some of the efforts of protecting, while at the same time also promoting tourism. But when you, as you benefit as an investor, you can also not run away from the fact that you're not living in an island. The whole element of planet, people, and then also the issue of the profit. So if you balance those three very well, that you will do well. At some point, I need to engage Brian on something, but this issue of...
Jonathan,
on the issue of... the hawkers thing. I think, Jonathan, what I was pointing out is that it's not just about the county government, for example, of Nairobi. I'm talking about the all elements of law enforcement when it comes to an election year. So it's, I think, the context issue.
Who do you really think is, as you respond to that, who do you think is really to blame as far as the failure in resource management is concerned?
The system in place.
So in this case, all this the 48 government,
including the central government, because what happens is that, stop even the 48 government. Here, the security is bestowed on the central government, which should be able to oversee proper management of the country's affairs in terms of security.
No, I'm talking about the resources.
The resources, of course, another thing is that the resources, they work currently with the county governments. But then here is a time resources they are restrained, where people, they have nothing unless they invade those ranches. Otherwise, all of them, they'll die, their properties will go. Therefore, the only thing I want to agree that there must be that relationship, between the headers and the owners, the investors, which will be able to solve the problems most in the Laikipia. But then I want to point out on the hawkers. Hawkers is a hot potato. Leave about even issues of the court order. If these people, they were to chase hawkers out of the streets,
they'll be out of their seats.
They'll be out of their seats, because what happens is that their opponents, who happens to be the government who are sitting in, they'll use it that you can't chase out people who don't have a living. You know, therefore they must deal with it in a manner suggesting that until under such a time that elections are over. That's the only time they'll now start putting also their muscles
so, but
in.
How do we, for example, balance what Jonathan has pointed out, that one of the tenets of a civilized state is upholding the rule of law. So where do you balance consistency in enforcing the law and the issue of political interests?
You can't talk of civility whereas people don't have something to put on their table. Whereas
only a full person can be civil. Is that what you're saying?
No, not really. I'm not saying so. You know what happens is that a city like this one, where there is no proper roadmap on how to sort out that issue, this issue did not start yesterday. It has been there. And especially now that we are headed to elections, you will see more
and more
coming into the street.
Just like Vincent said.
Yeah, live about the CBD, even up market. That is in Kilimani and other places.
Well, then this is a culmination of the incidents that's happening in life. Yeah, it's quite interesting. I want us to take a commercial break, but before we do that, gentlemen, what's your take on the reaction of the police spokesman Charles Owino over the story that a chopper carrying Inspector General Bwenet was shot at? He says, how can the IG be shot at when he was with armed police officers?
What will stop him being shot at?
Precisely.
Simply because
they say that is a fabrication by people trying to paint the picture of anarchy.
You know, I think what I'm struggling with here is you have a whole of your army keeping peace in Somalia, you have a whole of your army keeping peace in South Sudan, and then in your own country there is no peace. I think there's something wrong somewhere that we need to look at a little deeper and understand why is it that we can be overrun by militia while we have a competent, well-funded army. and security apparatus?
I honestly don't have all the facts, and being an analyst, I think I'd want
to get,
I need to have the facts. But the reality is that the country is not secure as we all would want to see happen. And I want to just add to what Mishima has pointed out, that when we talk about security, it is not entirely, whereas it is the national government that's responsible, but it requires the partnership of all. For a secure, for example, Nairobi, it has to be required the national government, the county government, and the residents of Nairobi. Because without that, it's not possible to hire a policeman for everyone. True.
We take a commercial break. We'll be right back to the news review segment of the Power Breakfast Show. My name is Charles Odhiambo. When we come back, we'll be looking at the deadline set by the IEBC as far as voter listing are concerned.